University of California, Irvine, on behalf of the Samuel Jordan Center for Persian Studies and Culture and the Farhang Foundation, I'd like to welcome you to today's program. This is our second annual Mehrigan celebration that we are holding at UC Irvine in collaboration with the Farhang Foundation. And I think the idea was to not only celebrate the coming of Auten, but also specifically focus on Persian literature and important aspects of Persian world that gets less discussed, at least in academia. And so we've invited two wonderful scholars, eminent scholars, to come and speak with us about some of the important Persian poets who just accidentally fall in the same century, at least of Common Era. The theme of this year's Mehrigan celebration is being present. But I guess I should ask Dr. Hushang Dadgostar, who's been really the engine behind making this program happen every year, to come before us and perhaps say a few words on behalf of Farhang and also the vision of this series. Please.
First, it's a pleasure to welcome everyone to the second annual Mehrigan conference at UCI, which is happening with great participation from Jordan Center with the director, Dr. Turaj Daryayi, and also about the Farhang Foundation. As you saw in the video, I don't want to belabor on that, just the mission of Farhang is to support and the promotion of Iranian art and culture. And throughout history, when humanity has been bruised in the darkness of ignorance, always art and culture has been the real power behind bringing, expanding the light through art and culture and to lift humanity to the levels to overcome the darkness. And all the great work of Iranian thinkers and philosophers is filled with unforgettable moments of love, of human courage, human power, and which all with deep psychological and practical effect and work. So I don't want to take much of your work. We have two excellent scholars here tonight, and with all the credit to Dr. Daryayi for going through arrangement with, really it's not easy to have Professor, you know, Alan William coming from United Kingdom to present, you know, on the Jalaluddin Rumi, and we have Dr. Sarmi here tonight, and she will be talking about Attar, which is one of the main pillar of really our philosophy. And so here is Mehrigan, and that Mehrigan, as you all know, is the time of harvesting. Harvesting is to get the sum up, the result of what we are doing. So every year, we are reminded with Mehrigan to sum up what we have done. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Dadgostar. So as I mentioned, we have two wonderful scholars who come to Persian literature and poetry from two different training and perhaps looking at it in a different light. And I think that's what makes this wonderful today, this program. And if I may, first allow me to introduce our first speaker, Professor Alan Williams, who is, of course, the British Academy Wolfson, research professor and the Leverhulme Trust major research fellow and professor of Iranian studies and comparative religion at the University of Manchester. So he's with us all the way from England. And let me just briefly say something about Professor Williams rather than just read off the list of his many publications, although I should mention his books, because he's written widely on ancient, medieval, and modern Iranian world. His first book was the Pahlavi Revayat, Accompanying the Dadistan Dinig, a difficult, copious Middle Persian or Pahlavi Zoroastrian text, which came out also in two volumes, almost 500 pages or longer, perhaps. 800, I stand to be corrected. So he started his work with that in the 1990s. And then he moved, and so he's not bound by pre-Islamic, Islamic, these types of artificial boundaries, you might say, and published the spiritual verses, the first book of the Masnavi Manavi. And then he worked back most recently on the Zoroastrian myth of migration, the Qissei Sanjan, a wonderful Zoroastrian text telling us the story of the narrative of the migration of the Zoroastrians from Iran to India, which, by the way, he will be giving a talk on this Tuesday at 6 o'clock at the Jordan Center for Persian Studies. His current project is, which is funded by the British Academy and the Walston Foundation and the Leverhulme Trust, is the monumental translation of Rumi's Masnavi into English. Professor Estelami did a wonderful edition, Persian edition, and now Professor Williams is taking on the English translation and, of course, in dialogue with Professor Estelami. And I think he's halfway through, and so we're looking very much forward to this monumental translation, which a great sort of Iranian scholar who does ancient languages, so he really knows the structure of this Iranian language, to present us very soon. I should say that among other things that he's done on Rumi or Maulana is a four-set CD set, the spiritual verses of Masnavi Manavi, Book One, which is translated by, of course, Professor Williams and read by Anton Lesser. It's a four-set CD, a wonderful, actually, narration and with very nice music of the Masnavi, which he did, and actually we have copies of it outside if you're interested to buy them. They're available for purchase at the table outside. And so he's now concentrating on the Masnavi. So without further ado, I'd like to ask Professor Williams to come and speak with us about the many voices of Maulana, soliloquies and intimations in the Masnavi of Rumi. Please, Professor Williams.
Durud, salam, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm hobbling around because I've just had a knee operation. I'm not, don't really need this, but I do fall over sometimes, so this helps. I'm going to put it down here. Now, I've got a PowerPoint, lots of pictures, which you'll need. I hope that I'm not going to bore you. I've got a pointer as well. I'm not going to point it at you. So this is my title, Rumi and His Many Ways of Speaking. I'll tell you about me in a minute, but first of all, I'd like to thank my hosts here, primarily the Farhang Foundation for inviting me, and the two gentlemen, Husheng, and I've just written their names down so I don't mispronounce them. And you've just heard from one of them, Dr. Husheng Dadgustar. I'm really grateful to you for inviting me. And also Alireza Rex Ardekhani, the executive director. And not least Turaj for persuading me to take time from my desk, which I'm very jealous of and very protective of, because I'm shackled to my desk for 6 years.
I've got 3 years from the British Academy and 3 years from the Leverhulme. So I'm kind of getting out for a week to LA from rural Derbyshire, where I live 30 miles south of Manchester in northern England. I literally live in the sticks. So I'm going to begin by telling you that Mehrigan is actually a Zoroastrian festival originally, associated with Mithra, the god of contract, harmony, agreement, love. So I'm going to begin with the first few lines of my 2009 book, Benami Izadidan na Yesobhan, Behardam mi sorayam nokte az jan, Faravan shokr mi guyam shab o roz, ke az shokrash mara jan ast firuz. Bejoz zikrash naguyam gah o bigah, ke u bar alam omad javedan shah. It goes on for a mere 432 couplets. Something of a quite a different dimension from the Masnavi I'm going to talk about today, which, as you know, is 25,650 couplets long. This is his great didactic work. Excuse me for reading from a script, but it's quite detailed what I'm going to say, and I'm going to talk to you for about 40, 45 minutes, and I think I'm talking to the converted, so to speak. I'm talking to Iranians, most of you, aren't you? So I can see from your faces that you know what I'm going to talk about. And I'm going to make a fool of myself by reciting in Persian, but mostly in English translation. I'll put the translations on the screen. Essentially, I'm going to talk today about Rumi's extraordinary polyphony. Polyphony is the word that I use. It means that what we're talking about is not so much a text as an incredible social being. It's something which has united people for 800 years, for 750 years. It is part of Sufi culture, part of Iranian literature, and is now part of world culture. And my job as a translator, I mean, there is an elephant in the room, and that is, I haven't mentioned Nicholson yet, but I shall do, of course. It has been translated before, but what I want to do is to I'm translating it for a new generation of people who can't understand Nicholson. My students can't understand Nicholson, I'm afraid. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to talk about polyphony, and I'll explain what I mean by that. Essentially, I want to talk about why and how does Rumi's work inspire readers and listeners today, even at a distance of 7.5 centuries from beyond an even greater cultural horizon. To speak in the metaphors of mystical language, Irfani language, the answer is, the reason why he appeals to us is his understanding of the human heart and his knowledge of how to speak to this heart. He knows how to speak to your heart. People think that the Masnavi is all about stories. Well, in a sense, it is stories, but as you will know, if you've tried to read it, as opposed to listen to those stories chosen by others to tell as a whole, if you've tried to read the Masnavi, you'll realize he quickly derails you from lulling you into false consciousness. He wakes you up from fantasy. He doesn't take you into fantasy. More on that later. Above all, he forms a kind of relationship with the reader right at the beginning of the text. This is a most interesting phenomenon, and it's a very moving thing to witness. One is not taken in. One is not fooled into a fantasy. One meets Jalaluddin, Rumi, Balkhi in the first few lines of the Masnavi, and one forms a relationship with him that stays right the way through. And so what I say is that reading a text and my working on this text is like ascending an unimaginably great mountain without pathways. with only a single guide who never leaves the reader's side. That is what I hold on to when I'm struggling up this mountain, step by step. I never look at the summit because it makes me fall off. It's just too big to contemplate, so one step at a time. So, a little background information, which you don't need, so I'm going to go through this very quickly. I hope this thing works. Doesn't work? Where do I point it? That's the question. That works. Well, I'll use the mouse. Oh, right. That way. Okay. All right, that's easy. Old technology. Put this away. Keyboard. Okay, so you know his dates. He's a 13th century Miladi creature, and he is the most renowned. Superlatives are odious, but and some would say that others are more famous than him. But I would say, as a world figure globally now, he's probably, well, as well known as Hafez or Saadi, perhaps more so in America. Of course, he's Persian speaking, and let's not forget that, those who claim that he speaks other, that he wrote in other languages. I won't go into that. But he was born in Balkh in eastern Khorasan on the borders of modern Tajikistan and Uzbekistan. And his family, as you all know, migrated in flight from the Mongol hordes 2,500 miles by land to Konya in central Anatolia, now Turkey, then Rum, hence his Western name, Rumi, literally the Westerner, the Roman, the Byzantine. He is claimed as a national poet by the Afghans, the Iranians, the Tajiks, the Turks, the Uzbeks, and now by Americans. I'm glad you've laughed. I wondered how that would go down in America. But you see the joke. So just on a map, I don't know whether you can see, but I put the two. He was born in Balkh, ancient Bactria, and he was born outside of Balkh. It's recently been shown by Frank Lewis. But he migrated with his family via Mecca and Medina and all the cities of the Central Islamic Empire, settling finally in Konya. There you see it. Now, I'm going to press on. Here is a picture from a beautiful manuscript that is in the British Library. It's a Safavid, an early Safavid manuscript. Very unusual in that it has some 19 full-page, mostly, illustrations. Very unusual for a sacred text like the Masnavi. Most Masnavis, early Masnavis, were not illustrated, and there are very few illustrated manuscripts until the 18th and 19th centuries. And this is taken to be a portrait of, it's a full page, this is just a detail of Jalaluddin, of Maulana, as I shall call him now, as Maulana teaching in discourse. And from this, you see these sorts of portraits are part of the same kind of iconographic tradition. And you see, this is the serious philosopher Rumi. This is the more devotional, the more benevolent Sufi teacher figure. And then we have more kitsch images like this that are par for the course in the Maulana industry, the Mevlana industry in Turkey. Now, his works, as you know, he wrote thousands of ghazals, rubaiyat, tarji'at, and qasideh. The Divan-e Kabir, or the Divan-e Shamsi Tabrizi, as it's called, a voluminous work which I don't think there'll be time in my lifetime to translate, but we're hoping to coordinate a team of scholars to produce a complete translation. And that is, plans at least for this are underway. The Masnavi is what I'm concerned with, the spiritual couplets. Masnavi and Matnavi is a very difficult term to translate. Spiritual is not a word I particularly like. It means, of course, meaning. It means spirit, meaning. It even means it's a name for God. Masnavi clearly is a common term, just meaning couplets. It's a single, we could say it's a single poem, but it's a single work in six daftars. And the prose works, the Fihi Mafi, the sermons, and the letters. The Masnavi as a work of Islamic piety. Now, something happened there. So the six books of the Masnavi total 25,600 baits. This is the equivalent of 52,000 verses of poetry and single verse lines in English. So there's no real comparison. It's five times longer than what most Westerners consider to be a voluminous work, The Great Paradise Lost. It's only a fifth of the size of the Masnavi. It's three times longer than Dante's Divina Commedia, and it's just under twice the length of Homer's Iliad and Odyssey. What a lot of people don't know is that it's actually very much more a tafsir of the Quran than people imagine. That's not a terribly popular thing to say in California. In fact, on the radio recently, I was interviewed about this time of last year on BBC Radio. It was a tri-location thing with Fatemeh Keshavarz in Washington and a gentleman in California and moi in Manchester in a studio in Salford. And they were trying to coordinate a discussion, and we kind of fell out on live on air because this gentleman from California, whose name escapes me at the moment, said that the Masnavi or Rumi was unsympathetic towards the Quran, and that Rumi's works had nothing to do with the Quran. And I rather contested that. Well, not as vociferously as Fatemeh Keshavarz did, but it just happens to be a matter of fact that there are 997 actual quotations from the Quran referring to every single one of the 114 surahs, except seven of them. I've named them there on the screen. And far more translated verses from the Quran, which Maulana very deftly translated into Persian. Translation is okay, you know, so long as it's not represented as the word of the Quran. So he wasn't doing anything wrong by translating them into Persian. You just can't call them that. That is not the Arabic of the Quran itself. There are then paraphrases of some 6,000 of his couplets are paraphrases of the Quran. And he alludes to and repeats, sometimes more than once, 560 separate different hadith. So I think it's fair to say that it has a pretty firm foundation in Quran and Hadith. There we have the voluminous and single-bound manuscript called the G manuscript in Konya. Has anybody seen this? Yes, if you've been to Konya, it is there in the Mevlana Museum on display. It's also on my desk at home in facsimile. The Turkish government produced a full-scale facsimile, which weighs 10 kilos. Not a handy paperback pocket edition, but very beautiful thing to work from. This is the way the text is written. These are the illuminated pages, and other pages are... Now, the famous quotation attributed to Jami is Masnavi Matnavi Molavi Hast Quran Dar Zabane Pahlavi. The Masnavi of meaning of our master, it is the Quran in the Persian language. This is attributed, possibly apocryphally, to Jami, but I think the sense of it is that it is a truly great work and it is inspired by the Quran. Now, I'm going to move on to show you and to show you the first voice that we encounter of Maulana. I do not like talking to microphones. I'm used to shouting at students with my own voice. But I will talk from here because otherwise it won't be picked up on the recording. There's quite a lot of you, so Can you hear me at the back clearly? Yes, good. So the first voice that we encounter in the Masnavi is the introductions, which are variously in Arabic and Persian. I think I'll get it wrong if I do, but three of them are in Arabic and three of them are in Persian, and it's not every other one. He kind of fools you. The first one is certainly in Arabic, and the second one is in Persian, and the third one is in Arabic, I think, but I can't remember. And they alternate, but not exactly. And I'm going to read my translation of the. This is what I would call the authoritative. This is the voice of the introductions, which I think is the most transcendent voice that you will find in the Masnavi. It's not in poetry. It's in the same kind of poetic prose that the Quran is written in. It's very reminiscent. Not least, there's a lot of quotation from the Quran. So it goes like this. I think I've translated it. Yeah, here we are, so you can read it with me. This is the book of the Masnavi, and it is the root. It is the roots of religion in respect of revealing the secrets of attainment and of certainty, and it is the greatest knowledge of God, and it is the most radiant way of God, and the clearest proof of God. The likeness of its light is like a niche in which there is a lamp shining with a radiance brighter than the dawn. It is the paradise of the heart, with springs and boughs among which there is one, which the followers of this way call Salsabil. And among the possessors of the stations and graces, it is best as a station and fairest place of repose. The virtuous eat and drink there, and the free are gladdened and overjoyed by it. And like the Nile of Egypt, it is a drink to the patient and an affliction to the people of Pharaoh and the unbelievers, as he has said, in this way he causes many a one to go astray, and in this way he guides many a one aright. It is a cure for hearts and remover of sorrows and uncoverer of the Quran, source of abundance and boons and healer of characters, by the hands of messengers noble and most virtuous who forbid, saying, none but the pure can touch it, a revelation from the Lord of the worlds. Falsehood cannot reach it from before or from behind. And God observes it and watches over it, and he is the best and guardians of guardians, and he is the most merciful of the merciful. And it has other titles by which God honored it. And we have constrained ourselves to this little, for the little is a sample of the much, and a mouthful is a sample of the pool, and a handful is a sample of the great threshing floor. Now, here is the great first two pages of the folios, the facing folios of the Konya manuscript, beautifully illuminated. I cannot tell you how exquisite the Seljuki script is to read after you are used to, I'm used to reading Nastaliq script. This is beautifully clear and simple, you can see, and there'll be close-ups, I think, later. This is the famous Nename. Every taxi driver in Iran can complete the sentence. If I start by saying, Bishnoi ne, I'll get the answer from the front. You know, but they always get it wrong because they go from the wrong manuscript. The G manuscript actually has it more correct, but we won't go into that today. But, well, I will actually. I'll go into it now because you'll know it as Bishnoi ne, won't you? Bishnu Azne, you know it as. Bishnu Azne. But the G manuscript, as you can see, if you look carefully, class. Oh, where's my pointer? If you look carefully, you'll see up here it says Bishnu Inne. Chun Shekoyat Mikonad. As Dudai Ho, Hekoyat Mikonad. Now you will know it as Bishnu Azne, Chun Hekoyat Mikonad. As Dudai Ho, Shekoyat Mikonad. But that is not what the G manuscript actually says. And it's this is the oldest tradition of manuscript. Also the one in the Cairo library it has the same text. And there was this deviation or this correction of the text came about fairly early on. And so we have two traditions, but this is the original version of it. So I'll recite from the G manuscript, but not for very much because it will... great with some of you who, I should really invite one of you to come up and read it for me. My wife usually does this for me. بشنوین نه چون شکایت می کند از جدایی ها و حکایت می کند که از نایستان تا مرا ببریده اند در نفیرم مرد و زن نالیده اند سینه خواهم شرح شرح از فراق تا بگویم شرح درد اشتیاق هر کسی که دور ماند از اصل خیش باز جوید روزگار وصل خیش من به هر جمعیتی نالان شدم جفت بد حالان و خوش حالان شدم هر کسی از زن خود شد یار من از درون من نجست اسرار من سر من از ناله من دور نیست لیک چشم و گوش را آن نور نیست تن ز جان و جان ز تن مستور نیست لیک کس را دید جان دستور نیست آتش است این باغ نای و نیست باد هر که این آتش ندارد نیست باد آتش عشق است کاندر نی فتاد جوشش عشق است کاندر می فتاد نی حریف هر که از یاری برید پرده هاش پرده های ما درید همچون نی زهری و تریاقی که دید همچون نی دمساز و مشتاقی که دید نی حدیث راه پرخون می کند قصه های عشق مجنون می کند محرم این هوش جز بیهوش نیست مرزبان را مشتری جز گوش نیست در غم ما روزها بیگاه شد روزها با سوزها همراه شد روزها گر رفت گو رو باک نیست تو به مان آن که چون تو پاک نیست هر که جز ماهی ز آبش سیر شد هر که بی روزیست روزش دیر شد در نیابد حال پخته هیچ خام پس سخن کوتاه باید و سلام There are another No That's like clapping in an Anglican church You can't do that But thank you He's just said assalam because the raw can't know the state of one who's cooked, so this discussion must be brief, farewell. And of course, he then picks it up and goes on for another 26,582 lines. I'll read my translation because for those of you who didn't understand a word of that, it goes something like this. Now, I've translated it into what's called blank verse, unrhymed, iambic pentameter couplets. There's no need to remember that. You won't be tested on it afterwards. But what it means is this is the language of Shakespeare's tragedies and Milton's Paradise Lost. It's a register, it's a tone which has very broad dramatic potential in it. It's not, unfortunately, rhymed heroic couplets are the stuff of satire, on the one hand, like Pope and Dryden wrote in rhymed heroic couplets. And many Iranians would prefer that we rhymed the translation of the Masnavi, but it's impossible to do that in English without either, on the one hand, making it slightly laughable and satirical, or on the other hand, making it slightly infantile, because it sounds doggerel, and it's kind of nursery rhyme. So it's not rhymed, and by not rhyming it, I have much greater freedom to be true, shall we say, or equivalent to the original. That's my thinking, anyway. Here's the translation of the first few lines. Listen to this reed as it is grieving. It's telling of the tales of separations. Since I was severed from the bed of reeds, in my cry men and women have lamented. I need the breast that's torn to shreds by parting to give expression to the pain of heartache. Whoever finds himself left far from home looks forward to the day of his reunion. I was in grief in every gathering. I joined with those of sad and happy state. Each person thought he was my bosom friend, but none sought out my secrets from within me. My secret is not far from my lament, but I, Andea, have no illumination. There's no concealment of the soul and body, yet no one has the power to see the soul. The reed flute sound is fire, not human breath. Whoever does not have this fire, be gone. The fire of love is burning in the reed. The turbulence of love is in the wine. The reed is friend to all who are lovelorn. Its melodies have torn our veils apart. Whoever saw a poison and a cure, a mate and longing lover like the reed? The reed tells of the road that runs with blood. It tells the tales of Majnun's passionate love. The sense is closed to all except the senseless, and words are all the ear can ever purchase. In all our grief, the days turned into nights. The days fell into step with searing pains. If days are gone, say go. There is no fear. And stay, O you who are uniquely holy. For all except the fish, his flood's too much. For all who have no bread, the day is long. The raw don't know the state of one who's cooked. So this discussion must be brief. Farewell. Be free, my son. I haven't read this in Persian, but a translation is the end of the name on me. Be free, my son, and break your chains asunder. How long will you be slave to gold and silver? If you should pour the sea into a pitcher, how much will it contain? A best a day's worth? The greedy eye is a pitcher never filled. The pearl won't fill the discontented shell. They will be wholly cleansed of greed and faults, whose clothes are torn to shreds by lover's passion. Rejoice, O love that is our sweetest passion, physician of our many illnesses, relief from our pomposity and boasting, O you who are our Plato and our Galen. For love, the earthly body soared to heaven, the mountain took to dancing and to skipping. When love approached Mount Sinai's soul, O lover, Sinai was drunk and Moses fell a swoon. If I were pressed to my companion's lips, then like the reed, I'd tell what must be told. A man cut off from fellow native speakers is tongue-tied, though he has 100 songs, as when the rose is gone, the garden faded, you will no longer hear the nightingale. The lover is a veil, all is the beloved. The beloved lives, the lover is deceased. When love no longer has a care for him, he's like a wingless bird. Alas for him. How can I understand the things around me when my companion's light is not around me? Love is demanding that these words come out. How can a mirror be without reflection? Do you know why your mirror tells of nothing? The rust has not been taken from its surface. Now listen to this story, O my friends. It truly is the essence of our state. This is the first soliloquy of the Masnavi that segues perfectly into the first story. And I've done a close analysis of this soliloquy, as I call it, and it really does stand alongside some of the great soliloquies of great literature. And one thinks of Shakespeare and so on. But this has not really been recognized, that Rumi is a writer of this caliber, and it's high time that he was on the top shelf of the world's literary shelves and was celebrated for the truly global and world-excelling status it should have. Now, one of the reasons that I have been awarded this prestigious British Academy and Leverhulme thing that allows me not to teach undergraduates and graduate students for 6 years and not to sit in committee meetings wasting my time, one of the reasons that these two prestigious bodies have done this is because I told them, I said, the Masnavi is the antidote to all forms of Muslim extremism, Islamic extremism in the world. If you want to understand the true heart of Islam, you had better understand the Masnavi, because you will need it to explain the text which is at the heart of Islam, the Quran. You will need to understand a text which, you know, this great... Anyway, they believed me. Thank goodness they did. Otherwise, I'd still be teaching undergraduates and not getting on with translating the Masnavi, which I'm doing at an incredible rate, and I mean an incredibly slow rate, because I do translate very slowly, as somebody once said to me in an audience, oh yes, Alan Williams puts the later into translator. So I thought it was very funny, but very cruel to say in front of a large audience. Wahhabism, let's just have one slide on Wahhabism, because this is what is part of the problem, as you well know. Ibn Abdul Wahhab, 1703 to 1792, was the man who vehemently promulgated his literalistic interpretation of Islam, and at the same time, in a pact with Muhammad ibn Saud, which helped to establish the first Saudi state, beginning a dynastic alliance and power-sharing arrangement between their families, which continues to this day. And the Sufis were among the first to suffer from Wahhabism, because Ibn Abdul Wahhab's purpose was to cleanse the Arab Bedouin from the influence of Sufism and other so-called un-Islamic practices of devotion and piety. This is as long ago as the late 18th century. Wahhabism remains an exclusivist form of Islam that is hostile to both Shi'ism and Sufism. Rumi's Masnavi, as the greatest poetical work of the Sufi tradition, presents the radical alternative to this fundamentalist interpretation of Islam. It is the quintessence of a greatly more tolerant and enlightened Islam of Sufi teaching based on the love of God and a doctrine of the mystical unity of all creation. Anyway, that's enough on Wahhabism. And we're going to go back to the real world, and that is to the Masnavi. And I want this picture sits above my desk at home, and he is my hero. He died at the age of 72. I'm going to have to outlive him in order to finish my project, I think. Professor Reynold Allen Nicholson, he produced a complete edition and translation of the Masnavi from 1925 to 1940. This is the title page of the first edition. We are fortunate to have this monumental work of scholarship, but as Nicholson himself said in his introduction, his work is only a starting point, and one that was always somewhat inaccessible to non-scholarly readers. And his translations are now, frankly, difficult for all but the most determined enthusiasts. Has anyone tried to, apart from you, Turaj, tried to struggle through it? And with great success? I know some very devout Iranian groups do read it through, and Turks and English people in London sit there and pore through the Masnavi in all six volumes, and all credit to them, but I can't get my students to read a page without falling asleep. I'm not being facetious or disrespectful to them. And I understand why, because he used an archaic English prose in imitation of the King James version of the Bible, and that King James version of the Bible was already archaic when it was translated from the Greek and Aramaic and Hebrew. It was already archaic in King James's time. Moreover, Nicholson's translation is peculiar because all the passages that he regarded as salacious, the dirty bits, are done into a Latin. He went back to read Juvenal and Sallust and other Latin poets to translate the Latin. But above all, it's because it's translated into difficult, old-fashioned English and done into prose. So it completely takes the poetry out of the translation. There are many popular translations of, that's Estet Lamy's edition, from which I'm translating alongside the G manuscript. But Estet Lamy's edition is incredibly precise and faithful to the G manuscript and to the Cairo manuscript. And I'm going to see Mohamed Estet Lamy in Montreal in a few weeks' time, because I'm going to put together a facing page translation and text of the Masnavi. So you will be able, with your children, this is what I'm doing it for, the next generation, so that you can read the translation and they can see the Persian. You can read the Persian to them and they can read the English. And I think this is so important for the next generation. It's no use if American Iranians of the second generation, third generation can't read Persian. It'll help them to learn it, but they need to read it in English, and they need to read it in modern, accessible, rhythmic, musical English. That's my aspiration. Anyway. I'm really tickled by the... nobody would do that in England. In a lecture theatre. That's my first whoop I've ever had in a lecture. Thank you. I thank you very much for that. It's worth coming all this way just for the whoop. I love that. Oh, wow. So, let's move on. Now, these are the modern translators. This is Coleman Barks. This is what Coleman Barks looks like. And this is what Coleman Barks no longer looks like. I shouldn't say that because the chap is not very well at the moment, I think. But anyway, that's the picture on his website, the one on the right. Now, these guys, this is Nicholson, and this is Arbery. You heard of Arbery? Other translation. This is John Moyne, also known as, it doesn't quite come out, but he's also known as Javed Moyne. He was born Javed Moyne, but he was born in 1920 and died in 2014. And he was the person who worked with Coleman Barks to produce those translations that people have of the essential Rumi and so on. Well, I won't go into that. It's another lecture which I've given recently at a translation conference. But they're not translations, they're paraphrases, and they're very selective paraphrases. They're basically what I call fillet of fish. You know a McDonald's fillet of fish? Well, that's what Coleman Barks' translations are. With all due respect, they're delicious sometimes, if you're in the mood. And if you're really hungry and you need a fillet of fish, it's just the job. But it's not a living fish, and it's certainly not what the Masnavi is, which is the ocean of fish. So the difference between Coleman Barks and the Persian text of the Masnavi is the difference between a fillet of fish and an ocean full of living creatures, of which you, of course, are one. So... But on the plus side, Coleman Barks has introduced millions of people to the name of Rumi and to his work, so all credit to him and God bless him. Now, why am I showing a picture of a tapestry? Let me just remember. Ah, yes. It's because... I've studied the text in order to find the structure of the text. Now, it may come as a surprise to some of you, but the word text and the word textile actually come from exactly the same root, meaning something that is woven, textum. And textilis is a textile. And so a tapestry, a carpet like this, the wonderful Ardabil carpet in the Victoria and Albert Museum, I think there is another one in Los Angeles, isn't there? You've probably seen it, some of you, the great Ardabil carpet. Is it in the Getty Museum? Getty Art Gallery? Yeah. The Masnavi is, you know, it's analogous to this great carpet. You can't really see the detail when you look at the whole thing. You have to go up close. So there we are, carpet, textile, text. And what you don't want to do with a carpet is to unweave it when you translate it. You don't want to pull it to bits. You don't want to create strings of language that have undone the knots of the poetry. You want to keep the knots of the poetry tied so that the pattern can emerge. And what I've tried to do in my analysis of the text is to find what are the main structures, what are the main patterns that recur in the Masnavi. I can't see you over there because it's this light, but anyway, hello, it's nice to see you. That's better. If I do that, I can see all of you. So what I'm going to do is to put up a rather odd diagram next, which is that. It looks like something theosophical, and But it's actually the structure that I, this is the best way I can illustrate it pictorially, is as a structure. Now, what we've got here in the center is what I would call the social being of the Masnavi, that is the music, the interaction, the polyphony of the Masnavi. Can you imagine this as a sort of force field within, if you imagine that the perimeter, if we take the text as proceeding around this great 26,500 bait perimeter, this narrative discourse is proceeding in this, just for the sake of diagram, for convention's sake, is proceeding in a clockwise direction. Now, this is all diagrammatic, so none of it is actually literally true, except the point that I'm making, which is we've started at the top with the authorial voice, right? That is the soliloquy voice of the Nenome and also of the introductions. The introductions, the six introductions, are written at this very high transcendent level of the author talking from the highest level. He's not in an ecstasy when he writes these introductions, nor is he in an ecstasy when he writes the Nenome. He's not in an ecstasy. The text is raining down upon the individual rather than aspiring upwards, flying upwards in ecstatic flight. So the authorial voice is like the voice of the sheikh. It is the avuncular, the grand paternal voice who speaks from a great height, but also with great compassion to the readers, to the listeners. But very quickly, as Rumi has just indicated, he moves into story. He says, how did it go? The text itself, just a minute ago, we had it. He says, now listen to this story, O my friends. It truly is the essence of our state. And he moves straight into the story. Now, this diagram makes it look complex, but really it's quite simple because it follows the pattern. This is what I gave my students, this pattern, not this actual pattern, but I broke it down into these seven, what I called the seven voices or registers of the Masnavi, so that they could at any time in the text locate where they were, because they would fall asleep and look out of the window, and when they looked back into the text after looking out of the window, they would be lost because he would have moved on to a different voice. So by taking note of, for example, the tense of the verb, you can work out whether you're in a story or whether you're in the authorial voice or indeed in a didactic passage. We can't see the bottom of the slide, so it's hidden from you. This is a ser. It's a secret. What's at the bottom there? You'll never know, but I will reveal it to you. So from story, I'm saying that quickly we go into analogy. And from analogy, what this says here is dialogue. Those who come close to the screen will see all, and those who sit far away will see nothing. The effect that reading too much Masnavi has on you. Sounds like the old man. And then this here says homily. Now, that's not a word we often use these days, but it means sermonizing. It means it's a kind of moral discourse. So what I'm saying is that from analogy, and I'll explain what that is in a minute, he moves into dialogue, and I'll explain what that is in a minute, into homily. But crucially, quickly moves from homily into spiritual flight. I prefer that term, spiritual flight. And there's something particular about this modus, this register, or this voice, that is very distinctive from the moral discourse that precedes it. Now, the reason that I put all these interconnections is because he doesn't just go around the perimeter. He's constantly shifting. So, for example, he can go straight from story straight to homily. So he can take this line. From story straight across to homily. And then he can go from there. Now, the reason it comes back from spiritual flight through hiatus, and I'll explain that in a minute, back to the authorial voice, and why it is circular, is that he comes back to silence. I think it is because these portions of poetry were delivered of a, say, for example, a Thursday evening at the Khanagah, at the in front of his adepts. They were delivered extemporaneously. I think he had already worked out what he was going to say, and there were many tropes that he was using, so he could speak in kind of a formulaic way to some extent, and then extemporize like a musician working on, you know, a cycle of chords. He could, but he would move. He would move, say, just say, for example, through a 60-minute cycle of speaking, say, a couple of hundred baits, and then he would say, "Well, you're tired now. Let's stop." And it's that kind of cycle of beginning, middle, and end. But it's more complex than that. Because what's happening in here is something very, very interesting. Now, I'm going to give you an example. This, by the way, is a picture from the full-page illustration from the Safavid manuscript of the Masnavi illustrated that is in the British Library. This is in close-up. A very beautiful illuminated manuscript of 1532 or 3, produced in Tabriz, we think, probably for an aristocrat, judging by the expense that was spent on it. And it just happens to be the picture I've chosen for the front cover of the book that Penguin published in 2006 as Spiritual Verses. I said, "Call it Spiritual Couplets, please," but they didn't. And I said, "Call it The Spiritual Couplets, please," but they didn't. They called it Spiritual Verses. And it hasn't sold very many copies, and that's why I'm taking it to IB Tauris, who are going to produce all 6 volumes. Because Penguin have already got Coleman Barks, so they don't need me. So I'm coming off their list, and they can keep Coleman Barks. Or Coleman Banks, as he is on the title page of the Penguin. If you look at the English edition of the Essential Rumi, it's actually called in England, Selected Verses on the title page. Coleman Barks is misprinted as Coleman Banks. As a Freudian, I would tend to think that that is something of a slip. So, this is the story that inspired this picture, right? In fact, the text is up there in the Persian, if you can read the Nastaliq. And this is my translation. "One morning, there arrived a nobleman who ran into the court of Solomon. His face was pale with grief, his lips were blue. Said Solomon, 'What is the matter, sir?' 'Ezrael threw me such a look,' he answered, 'so full of anger and of enmity.' He said, 'Come tell me now what you desire.' 'O savior of my soul, instruct the wind to carry me from here to Hindustan, that maybe there your slave's soul will be saved.' Mankind is taking flight from poverty. Mankind's a morsel for desire and greed. The fear of poverty is like that fellow. Desire and greed are like his Hindustan. He ordered that the wind should quickly take him by river into inmost Hindustan. Next day, it was the time of court and council, when Solomon remarked to Ezrael, 'So, did you cast that look upon that Muslim so angrily to drive him from his home?' 'When did I cast a glance at him in anger? I was astonished when I saw him passing. For God had so instructed me, today you'll snatch his soul away in Hindustan.' Surprised, I said, 'Had he 100 wings, it would be far for him to go to Hindustan.' You must judge all the world's affairs like this. Be shrewd and open up your eyes and see. Who are we fleeing? Us, impossible. Who are we robbing? God. It is a sin." Now, the reason I've colored these in different colors, if I go back, is that what we have in the purple is what I would call narrative. This is the storytelling, right? And then we have in blue, we have the actual business of the story, but it's actually, we've already moved into dialogue. "What is the matter, sir?" Answer, "Ezrael threw me such a look." So now the difference is that in narrative is in the past tense, but the dialogue is in the present tense, and the dialogue actually brings it closer to you. It brings it into your imagination in a much clearer, more dramatic way than simply past tense narrative. So we have the conversation going on, and it's, there's a joke in there. You've all got the joke, haven't you? Yes. Israel, God, Israel, man in the street. Yeah. So then you see, once he's told the story, or he's halfway through the story, Rumi interjects, and what you've got in green is what I would call moral discourse. This is the homily, because it's Rumi going from, it's almost like it's an analogy that is also moving into moral discourse, because he's saying, if you understand this story, you'll see that mankind is like this man flying to Hindustan. He's taking flight from poverty. Mankind's a mortal for desire and greed. The fear of poverty is like that fellow. Desire and greed are like his Hindustan. That's a very bold metaphor to say that fear and poverty are like the Hindustan. We're running away from poverty. We're running to the Hindustan of desire and greed. But Rumi's like that. It really stretches your imagination like that. So then we go back to the narrative in purple, and then we have, it carries on in purple, and then we get more of this, the dialogue in blue, and then you'll see that God has instructed him, I put God in black, respect. Okay? Surprised, I said, and this is now Israel again, surprised, I said, had he 100 rumi, it would be far for him to go to Hindustan. And then Rumi in green again, that's homily, remember? And then I put the nocte, the point, is in red. Who are we fleeing? This is the point of the whole thing, that we're fooling ourselves if we try to flee from our fear. Who are we robbing with our greed? God. We're actually robbing God. So it's a sin. And that's the end of that particular little story. But in those few verses, it's very much more succinct in Persian, as you realize. He's covered an enormous amount of imaginative space. And above all, what you can see is a huge range of psychological teaching has been impacted on you through a very simple story. Anyway, you see the dervishes, the adepts, would study these stories, and they would read them, and they would imbibe them like a drink. They would take them into themselves and contemplate them. So that is an unfortunate thing about paperbacks, is that they seem disposable, like disposable literature, but these are important ideas. Now, I'm going to go on to another type of story, which this illustrates. This is the first story in the book, the first Hekoyat, the first Afsane. It's the story of the king and the slave girl, Kenizek. In former times, there was a king who was the ruler of this world and of the next. It happened that one day, the king went riding with all his retinue in search of game. The king espied a slave girl on the highway. The king became a slave boy to that slave girl. His fledgling soul aflutter in its cage, he paid his money and he bought the slave girl. Now when he'd bought her and he had enjoyed her, by heaven's fate, the slave girl turned to sickness. Now my students have just looked out the window, okay? And they look back and they see a man possessed an ass but had no saddle. He got a saddle, wolves had got the ass. Another had a pitcher but no water. He found the water, but he broke the pitcher. The king called in the doctors all around. Okay. Been looking out the window. What is this text all about then? I haven't got a clue, sir. Not a clue. Not the faintest. That's why I've had to explain it in terms of the switching between voices. And this comes, it's very similar in some ways to the way the Quran works. And if you don't read the Quran very attentively, you lose the plot. Because this what is going on is what is called in Arabic iltifat, or a switching of viewpoint, moving of your gaze, in Persian, eltifat. Yeah, is that what eltifat means? Is that right? You know, eltifat? As I understand it, eltifat means that, of switching of the gaze. So, this is what is happening here, that the what is in blue is an analogy that it interrupts the flow of the narrative. And it makes the point, here there are two analogies in the space of two baits, two separate analogies, one per bait. And then we go back to the story, the king called in the doctors all around, and it carries on. At the beginning of another story, we have this. There was a cruel king among the Jews, a Christian cleansing enemy of Jesus. It was the time of Jesus and his era, for he was Moses' soul and Moses his. The cross-eyed king divided up those two divine companions on the path of God. Now, we have our first analogy. A master told his cross-eyed servant, "Come, go on and get that bottle from the outhouse." The cross-eyed man said, "Which of those two bottles shall I bring you? Please tell me what you mean." The master said, "There aren't two bottles. Go leave off your squinting. Don't be seeing double." He said, "Oh, master, don't be so sarcastic." The master said, "Try breaking one of them." When he broke one, both disappeared from view. A man goes cross-eyed from his lust and anger. There was one bottle. Two appeared to him. He broke one, and there was no other bottle. Desire and anger make men go cross-eyed, for they distort the spirit from uprightness. When craving comes, then virtue is concealed. The 100 veils divide the heart and sight. A judge allows corruption in his heart. How can he know the oppressor from the victim? The king was so cross-eyed from Jewish hatred that we cry, "Oh, mercy, Lord, have mercy." I think you've got the point, haven't you? You now see that the switching between these registers or voices is not just because he can't tell a story without getting itchy feet and moving on. No, not like that at all. It's because this is how we think, actually. When we're thinking and when we're telling stories, this is actually, as musicians, pick up and work off each other, and you'll see it later when people are improvising and singing together and playing together. There's interaction between the verses, between the meanings, and this is what makes that social being in the middle. How am I doing for time, Turaj? Time to shut up? 2 or 3 minutes? I was thinking more of like... Anyway, I work well under pressure. So I won't have time to tell you about the voice of speech and dialogue of characters, because we've already done that. The moral reflection of homily, all I have to tell you is that he digs deep into Quran and Hadith, and he has the most stupendous recall of Hadith and Quran. He obviously was a Hafiz. He obviously had his years of learning at his father's feet and the feet of his other teachers bore fruit, and his great knowledge of Hadith. And also of very considerable knowledge of folk tales and of stories from the Panchatantra and the Kalila Wadimna tradition, the Aesop's fables he'd read deeply in Christian literature and in Jewish literature. I like this bit because he tells you why. It's all right, I really don't mind if nobody else minds, but... This text here explains an awful lot, because he's just come to the end of the famous story of the Caliph and the Bedouin, and it's all in the first book. I'm referring to that because it's published. But although this story's mystery is a snare, hear now the outward story to its end. And then he says this crucial thing: if spiritual explanation were enough, creation of the world were all in vain. If love were merely thought and merely meaning, your prayer and fasting would not have a form. The gifts of sweethearts to each other sent are nothing else but tokens of their love, so that a proof is given by the gifts of passions hid away in secret places. Because the outward acts of goodness tell of secret passions, O most worthy friend. So the story is not actually just the kernel. We normally think of the story as being the outer form, but it's actually the thing that you give, that Rumi is giving you, the gift of sweethearts to each other sent, are nothing else but tokens of their love. But without those tokens, the communication doesn't go on. So the ring on the finger, the present on the birthday or on the wedding anniversary, they are tokens of love to each other sent. And without them, trouble. So, moving on. I was just going to give you this wonderful passage, but I haven't got time. I'm prohibited from sharing it with you. So I shan't. This story anyway, the story of the parrot. But it is one of them. There is a. Oh, can I please just have 2 minutes? Yes. Yes. And he says, this is, yes. He says, گفت توتی را چه خواهی ارمغان کارمت از خطه هندوستان. He asked the parrot, what would you like that I could bring you from the land of India? The parrot said, when you see parrots there, and remember, look at the quotes, because we've started, there's the merchant asking the parrot, who I've made female, what gift would you like that I can bring you back from India? So, close quotation. The parrot said, and this is the beginning of the parrot's speech, when you see parrots there, explain to them my plight and say to them, now you see, quote within quote. So say to them, when you get to India, you, merchant, tell the parrots in India, quote, a certain parrot's desperate to see you, who by the fate of heavens in my prison. She sends you greetings and demands some justice and asks for help and means of guidance from you. She said, so now we're back into double quotes because it's a quote within a quote within a quote. Do you see it? Yeah? So the parrot said to the merchant, to say to the parrots in India, is it correct that I should languish, give up the ghost and die here all alone? And is this right that I'm in painful chains while you can flit about from bush to tree? Is loyalty of friends to be like this, I in this jail and you in beds of roses? Oh, sirs, will you remember this poor bird and in the meadow drink a draught to me? Friends' memory of their friend is most auspicious, more so when one is Leli, one Majnun. Oh, partners of your own beloved fair ones, I drink from cups filled with my own dear blood. Drink just one cup of wine in memory of me, if you do not see fit to give me justice. Or when you've drunk, pour on the dust a drink in memory of me, groveling in the dust. Where then, I wonder, is that bond and oath? Where are those the vows of those with lips like sugar? Now this, you'll know, this is a comment by, you can see this is moving into analogy. A servant is dismissed for bad behavior. When you behave oppressively, what's different? The harm you do in anger and in strife is sweeter than an ecstasy of harp strings. Something strange is happening here, because this isn't a parrot speaking. Parrots don't talk like this. They imitate people. This parrot's intelligent. It's got dramatic person. The harm you do in anger and in strife is sweeter than an ecstasy of harp strings. Your cruelty is better than a victory. Your scolding's more desired than life itself. This is your fire. Now, I put the U's here, you see, into the capital, because what we've done, we've switched from the to, you parrots in the trees of India. The to he's now talking to is to, the divine you. Your cruelty is better than the victory. Your scolding more desired than life itself. This is your fate. What is your fire? What does your light look like? This is your funeral, what's your wedding like? As for the sweetness which your violence holds, and for your subtlety, none plumb your depths. I weep, and then I fear he will believe me. Now there we've got a switch. This is an iltifat. It happens in the Quran all the time. He's talking to God, and then suddenly God is you. There's he, and then it switches to you. I love so much his violence and his grace. How wonderful I love these two extremes. Lord, says, if I leave this thorn bush for the garden, I'll sing for sadness like the nightingale. How wonderful, this nightingale who lifts his beak to eat the thorns within the rose beds. What kind of nightingale is this? A dragon. In love, all bitter things are sweet to him. And then he comes to this final verse of the passage, which is a kind of hiatus. It's also a kind of shut, a shut in... Probably Lenny Lewison told you this last year, but a shat is an exclamation, an ejaculatory expression that is just thrown out to heaven. And he says, Ashek e kol ast, o chod kol ast u, Ashek e chish ast, o eshke chish ju. He's lover of the whole, he is the whole, he's lover of himself, he seeks his love. Now that is... the spiritual flight has gone to its limit, and directly after that, Rumi ties a knot in it and says, that's enough, we stop. And so I'm going to have to do what Turaj tells me and do a hiatus here and stop. But thank you very much for your attention.
Who is local? which we're quite glad to have so close to us, is Dr. Suhaila Sarami, who had a different training in Persian literature, and that is to study at the University of Tehran with the great Professor Shafia Katkani, which most of you would know. And she has taught Persian literature, classical, and both modern literature in various universities, and has published a number of wonderful books on Attar, which appears to be her forte and expertise among all. She has worked at the wonderful Institute for Humanities and Cultural Studies, Pajushkade Ulume Insani, Bozorghe Kurdistan, a wonderful place that I very much like to visit whenever I get to go to Tehran. Among her books are Attar Neishapuri, an analytical survey on Attar's thoughts and mysticism, published in Tehran most recently. Also, Mystical Terms and Prominent Concepts in Attar's Language, and earlier on, The Visage of Society in Attar's Work. And I think her talk today is in relation to Attar's sort of society, and in Persian would be Simaye Jamee dar Asar Attar. So without further ado, please, Dr. Sarami.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your presence here. It's my honor to stand in front of you this evening. خانم ها و آقایان برای حضور گرمتون در اینجا سپاسگزارم. مهرگان رو هم به شما تبریک میگم و مایه سرفرازی منه که امروز یا امشب در خدمت شما هستم. از من خواستن که به زبان فارسی صحبت بکنم و مایه خوشحالی منه. وظیفه خودم میدونم از آقای دکتر تورج دریایی، آقای دکتر دادگستر، آقای دکتر اردکانی و دیگر دست‌اندرکاران بنیاد فرهنگ ایران و همینطور مرکز مطالعات ایرانی جردن سپاسگزاری کنم که این فرصت رو امروز در اختیار من گذاشتند که بتونم چند کلمه‌ای درباره عطار و جامعه او صحبت بکنم. اجازه می‌خوام که با شعر عطار و با شعری از عطار و از زبان خودش آغاز کنم. سایلی پرسید از آن شوریده حال، گفت اگر نام مهین ذوالجلال میشناسی بازگو ای مرد نیک. گفت نان است این به نتوان گفت لیک. مرد گفتش احمقی و بیقرار، کی بود نام مهین این شرم دار. گفت در قحط نشابور ای عجب، می گذشتم گرسنه 40 روز و شب. نشنودم هیچ جا بانگ نماز، نه دری بر هیچ مسجد بود باز. من بدانستم که نان نام مهیست، نقطه جمعیت و بنیاد دینست. فریدالدین عطار نیشابوری، شاعر بزرگ نیمه دوم قرن ششم و 15 سال اول قرن هفتم، در کتکن نیشابور به دنیا آمد. متاسفانه درباره زندگی او اطلاعات زیادی در دست نداریم. فقط میدونیم که با چند واسطه پیر معنوی او ابو سعید ابوالخیر صوفی بزرگ قرن پنجم بوده، پنجم هجری، و میدونیم که در نیشابور، در شادیاخ نیشابور به دست مغول‌ها کشته شده یا شهید شده. آثار بسیاری به عطار نسبت داده شده به دلیل اینکه عطارهای زیادی وجود داشته، هم پیش از عطار ما، هم همزمان با او، هم پس از او. ولی از بین این همه آثاری که منتسب هست به عطار، 7 اثر به عنوان آثار مسلم او شناخته شده است. 4 مثنوی، یکی مثنوی اسرارنامه که اونطور که محققان عطارشناس اظهار کردن، مثل دکتر شفیعی کتکنی و دکتر عبدالحسین زرینکوب، این هر دو اثر، اسرارنامه و الهی نامه که به صورت مثنوی تنظیم شده، هر دو بیان مرحله شریعت هست. و بعد منطق الطیر او هست که بیان مرحله طریقت، و مصیبت نامه که بیان مرحله حقیقت. دیوان عطار که شامل غزل‌ها، قصیده‌ها و ترجیع‌های اوست، و بعد مختارنامه که رباعیات بسیار زیبای عطاره که در بخشی از اونها هم زیر تأثیر خیام هست. و اثر دیگر، آخرین اثر، تذکرة الاولیا است که به نثر و شرح حال بزرگان تصوف و اولیا و مشایخ صوفیه است و 1-2 نفر از اولیاء دین، که زیباترین نثر شاعرانه فارسی است. عطار برای آثار عرفانیش و به عنوان شاعر عارف ایرانی شناخته شده، و اون چهره دیگر عطار که در پشت این چهره نهفته است، یعنی چهره یک شاعر معترض اجتماعی، چندان شناخته نیست. هرچند که این هر دو چهره، هر دو سوی در واقع دو سوی یک چهره هستند. من امروز با اجازتون تصمیم دارم که اون سوی چهره دیگر عطار رو دربارش صحبت کنم. به طور خلاصه میگم که بتونیم بریم سراغ مطلب اصلی. دوره عطار یکی از بدترین و سیاه‌ترین دوران‌های تاریخی ایران، دوره حکومت‌های خودکامه و که بر اساس نظام زمینداری یا فیودالیسم بودند، جنگ‌های برون مرزی که بدترین اونها، یکی از بدترین این جنگ‌ها، جنگ با خطائیان و با قزها بود که نیشابور به کلی ویران شد، بعد جنگ‌های فرقه‌ای مذهبی که هر روز یک دسته از طرفداران یک فرقه و یک مذهب می‌ریختن به مدرسه و مسجد و کتابخانه اون یکی دسته و ویران می‌کردند و در آتش کتاب‌ها رو می‌سوزاندند و فردا اون دیگری می‌آمد به سراغ اینها. جنگ‌های تعصب مذهبی و جزمی‌گرایی، بعد جنگ‌های داخلی بود که جانشینان پادشاهان یا در همون عهد اونها فرزندانشون، بستگانشون برای به دست آوردن قدرت با همدیگه جنگ داشتند و دائم مملکت در کشمکش و قوغا بود و مردم بیچاره آسایش و آرامشی نداشتند. و به دنبال این همه مسلماً جنگ و هرج و مرج، فتنه و فساد و فقر و قحطی و بیماری و مرگ در انتظار مردم بود. عطار معاصر دو سلسله معروف سلجوقی و خوارزمشاهی است که متاسفانه اونقدر وقت نیست که بتونم اینها رو باز بکنم، شرایط تاریخی تلخی رو که مردم در این دوران داشتند و چه کسانی از بین رفتند در این دوره ها. احتمالاً کودکی عطار مصادف بوده با اواخر عصر سلطنت سلطان سنجر سلجوقی که حدود 60 سال بر ایران حکومت کرد و 20 سالش رو در خراسان گذراند. و زمان کودکی عطار که با اواخر عصر سنجر همزمان است در واقع پایان دوران طلایی حکومت سلجوقیانه که از ملکشاه سلجوقی شروع شده بود و با سنجر تمام شد. دوران پس از سنجر هم دائما جنگ و گریز و کشتار ادامه داشت و جنگ‌های داخلی و نبردهای مختلف فرقه عقیدتی دائما ادامه داشت. دوره خوارزمشاهیان هم به از این دوره نبود. اینها حکومت هر دو حکومت‌های بیگانه‌ای بودند یا مردم اونها رو بیگانه می‌انگاشتند که بعداً ایرانی شدند، از ترکانی بودند که به ایران آمده بودند و بعداً ایرانی شدند و اینها یک مش لشکری و مزدور رو در اختیار داشتند و به اونها متکی بودند و به مراتب بدتر از سلجوقیان بودند، اونطور که تاریخ نویسان ذکر کردند. در این دوره هم نظام مالیاتی بسیار سنگینی جاری بود و مردم در فقر و بیچارگی بودند و عطار چندین بار به این قضیه اشاره کرد. در یکی از شعرهاش بیان میکنه که هرگز پیرزالی پرنیازی نسازد خیشتن را پی پیازی پیازداغ، که تازان پی پیاز آن زن زال به نستانی تو چیزی در همه حال. ز یک یک بز مرائی می ستانی، مرائی مالیات بز و گوسفند و چارپایان، روی اون برگه ها نوشتم. گدائی به بود زین پادشایی. و البته این شعر و نمونه های اون بر واقعیت های تاریخی اسواره، چنان که به گواهی تاریخ نویسان وزیر طغرل سلجوقی در گزینی به بهانه ساختن اسباب مطبخ و شرابخانه سلطانی هزاران دینار مالیات بر شهرها سرشکن کرد، تا اونجا که طغرل از بیم آبرو به او پیغام فرستاد که تو مرا بدنام کردی، آیا کندن پوست بزرگان بس نبود که به ریختن خون فقیران و ضعیفان برخواسته ای؟ نامه های محمد غزالی، امام محمد غزالی به سنجر هم که او رو سرزنش میکنه که چرا از حال مردم بیخبری و خودت در آسایش و آرامش زندگی میکنی، بیانگر این وخامت این اوضاع است. اما بدترین جنگ هایی که در اون دوره رخ داد، بدترین جنگی که رخ داد، جنگ ایران با مغول ها بود که در حقیقت به دلیل بی‌سیاستی سلطان محمد خوارزمشاه، آخرین پادشاه خوارزمشاهی، این جنگ رخ داد، به خاطر اینکه خطائیان رو، قراخطائیان رو که همسایه ایران بودند از بین برد و در حقیقت سد بزرگی که مقابل مغول بود از بین رفت. و از سوی دیگر موقعی که سفیران چنگیزخان مغول به ایران آمدند، در واقع اونها اصلا در تصورشون نمی گنجید که بتوانند با امپراتوری بزرگ خوارزمشاهی جنگ کنند. اونها فقط آمده بودند برای اینکه ارتباط بازرگانی و تجاری برقرار کنند، ولی متاسفانه اینها تمام اونها رو کشتن، یعنی سفیران چنگیز رو با بی سیاستی کشتن، چون طمع کرده بودند در اموالی که اونها با خودشون داشتند. و به این ترتیب سیل خانمان برانداز مغول به ایران سرازیر شد و اونطور که تاریخ نویس ها نوشتند، آمدند و کندند و سوختند و کشتند و بردند و رفتند. تمام شهرهای ایران رو ویران کردند، به خصوص خراسان به جز یک دو شهر، و نیشابور در این میانه از همه بیشتر بدشانسی آورده بود، به خاطر اینکه نیشابوریان داماد چنگیز رو که توقاجار نام داشت کشته بودند و همسر او میخواست انتقام بگیره از اینها و بنابراین تمام مردم رو به صحرا برد و همه رو کش و دستور داده بودند که هیچ کس زنده نمانه. حتی همسر چنگیز دستور داد که گربه و سگی در اونجا زنده نمان و از کله ها مناره ساختند. متاسفانه شاعر دلسوخته ما هم در همین دوران به دست مغول ها کشته شد یا شهید شد. عطار انسانی آزاد، شاعری حساس و حکیمی اندیشمند است. او از آن دست عارفانی نیست که دل به گوشه خانقاه خوش کند، کجیها و کاستیهای جامعه را نادیده بگیرد، پای از زمین برکند و یک سره به آسمان برود. وی پیوسته در شعرهایش همگان را به کار و تلاش می‌خواند و از بیکارگی و تنپروری منع می‌کند. او در کنار نویسندگی و شاعری پزشک و داروساز بود و از راه داروسازی دائما با مردم در تماس بود و از دردها و رنجهای مردم با خبر بود. به همین دلیل ما در تمام آثار عطار رد پای مردم رو می‌بینیم و فریاد این مردم رو از گلوی عطار می‌شنویم. عطار از حیث بیان مفاهیم اجتماعی و همدردی با مردم عصر خود ظاهراً تند و تیزتر از سایر عارفان به نظر می‌رسد و شاید این از اون جهت باشه که تلخی زمانه او بیش از دیگران بود. شاید گفتن این نکته هم بد نباشه که او به حسین منصور حلاج، عارف بزرگ قرن سوم هجری، ارادت بسیار داره و نه تنها ارادت، در چند جا او رو حتی پیر خودش نامیده و همون خشم و اعتراض او رو در شعرهاش ابراز میکنه و از اندیشه او هم تأثیر بسیار گرفته. پیر ما بار دیگر روی به خمار نهاد، خط به دین برزد و خط بر خط کفار نهاد. باز گفتم که انا الحق زده ای سر در باز، گفت آری زده ام روی سوی دار نهاد. و شاید این گمان خیلی دور از تصور نباشه که در منطق و تر که معمولاً ما اون رو یک اثر عرفانی درجه اول میدونیم، عطار نظری به اناالحق حلاج داره. اونجا که سی مرغ در برابر سی مرغ قرار میگیرند، در حقیقت به نوعی میتونه اشارهی باشه به اناالحق حلاج. همینطور در مصیبت نامه که یکی دیگر از آثار عظیم عطاره که کمتر شناخته هست، در اونجا هم که سالک فکرت تمام آسمان و زمین و همه جا رو میگرده، هر دو دنیا رو میگرده، پیش فرشتگان مقرب میره، پیش اسرائیل و اسرافیل و پیامبران و تمام جاها میره و بر میگرده و میبینه که حقیقتی که دنبالش میگشت در درون خودشه و در دریای جان خودش غوطه بر میشه، در اونجا هم این احتمال بالاست که عطار زیر تأثیر اناالحق حلاج باشه. همچنین در کنار تفسیر عرفانی که ما از منطق و تر می کنیم، می توانیم تفسیر دیگری هم داشته باشیم با رنگ و بوی اجتماعی. سیمرغ می تونه تحقق روح یگانگی، روح پریشان و از هم گسیخته قوم ایرانی یا قوم‌های ایرانی باشه که در حقیقت که بر اثر فقر و جهل، تعصب و تفرقه‌های عقیدتی قومی و در کل آشفتگی‌ها و نابسامانی‌های پیاپی وحدت و یکپارچگی خودشون رو از دست دادن و بنابر این در وجود سیمرغ وحدت آرمانی خودشون رو دوباره پیدا می‌کنن. چه کسی میتوانست روح قومی هزارپاره مردمان ایران رو در یک جا گرد بیاره بجز سیمرغ بلند که جاش در کوه قاف و در آسمان ها بود و به دور از دسترس مردم خاران و جنگ افروزان. زبان رمزی گذشته از زیبایی های هنری پوششیست برای بسیاری از ناگفتنی ها، به ویژه در عصر متعصب و خونریز عطار که شاهد کشته شدن دو تن از بزرگان صوفیه هستیم، یکی عین‌القضات همدانی و که پیرو حلاج هم بوده و دیگر شیخ اشراق شهاب الدین سهروردی. بنابراین این احتمال قوی بر جا میمونه که عطار به زبان رمز به همون اناالحق حلاج اشاره کرده باشه. در آثار عطار میتوان ردپای تمام قشرها و طبقات اجتماعی را دید، مانند امیران، وزیران، دبیران، قاضیان و کلن تمام دیوانیان و لشکریان. و در مقابل مردمان ضعیف حال مثل کارگران، بردگان، روستاییان، راندگان جامعه، مانند دیوانگان، دگرباشان، گدایان و غیره که وی کوشیده است تا زبان حال آنها باشه. او نحوه زندگی این مردم رو تا جایی که براش ممکنه به خصوص در حکایت‌ها بیان میکنه، با نحوه لباس پوشیدن، نحوه رفتار، گفتارها، خیلی از نظر جامعه شناسی ادبیات و از نظر روانکاوی ادبیات این مثنوی های عطار حائز اهمیت هست. از اونجا که عرفان او از بینش سیاسی و اجتماعیش جدا نیست، به نظر میرسه که در پاره ای از آموزه های عرفانی روی سخن او بیشتر با زورمندان و خداوندان زر و زور هست. مثلا اصطلاح های مثل قناعت، فقر، تواضع، اینها به درد درویش و بیچاره‌ای که خود به خود خودش هم قناعت داره، هم فقر داره و هم تواضع نمیخوره. قاعدتا میبایست روی سخن او با کسانی باشه که خداوندان زر و زور بودن در جامعهش. هرچند نمیتوان منکر شد که آموزه های او برای همه قشرهای اجتماعی بوده. در زمانی که نفس پرستی، دنیا دوستی و جهل و تعصب مایه ستیز و مایه جنگ های فرقه‌ای و مذهبی است و غرور و مناعت مردم لگدمال دنیا داران میشه، طبعا عطار میباید به اونها چنین پندهایی بده و از اونها بخواد که به آموزه های عرفانی او بیندیشند و به اون گوش بکنند. خود او هم همطور که معروفه و همه میدونیم هرگز هیچ کسی رو مدح نکرده در زندگی. در شعری میگه شکر ایزد را که درباری نیم. این رو خیلی ها درباری میخونن، ولی در اون موقع دربار با معنای امروز ما رایج نبوده. برای همین بهتره که در بار خونده بشه، بار به معنی غم. شکر ایزد را که درباری نیم، بسته هر ناسزاواری نیم. من ز کس بر دل کجا بندی نهم، نام هر دون را خداوندی نهم. نه طعام هیچ ظالم خورده‌ام، نه کتابی را تخلص کردم. انتقاد او بیشتر به صورت داستان و زبان دیگران هست و چه بسا بعضی از این داستان‌ها واقعیت تاریخی داشته باشند، اما بعضی از اونها رو خودش ساخته و در هر دو نوع در هر حال اعتراض خودش رو بیان میکنه. او ضمن ستایش کار و کوشش و ستایش کسانی که کار و کوشش میکنند و حاضر نیستند که در جامعه زیر منت دیگران برن، در برابر کسانی که در حقیقت قشرهای بالای جامعه هستند و طبقه بالای جامعه به حساب میان، در برابر خداوندان قدرت و مکنت و در برابر ریاکاران، دو دسته رو به طور مشخص میاره و قرار میده. یکی از اونها دیوانگان هستن. دیوانگان در حقیقت چشمان پنهان عصر هستن. اینها معمولا جاشون در خرابه ها، در روی تل خاکستر، در ویرانه ها، در تون حمام و جاهایی است که هیچ کسی نمیره. لباس ها و جامه ها کثیفه، همیشه مگس و جانوران موذی دوربر اونها رو گرفته و همیشه هم گرسنه هستن. و اینها نه چون دیوانه هستن، نه از حد و تعذیر شرعی میترسن، چون از نظر شرع اینها آزادند، نه از عرف و نه از قانون. بنابراین هر طور که دلشون میخواه حرفشون رو میزنن و تعارفی هم با کسی ندارن. بنابراین عطار خیلی هوشمندانه اینها رو انتخاب کرده و آورده و قرار داده در برابر کسانی که میخواد به اونها اعتراض کنه و نه از زبان خودش. در حقیقت این دیوانگان وجود تمثیلی خود شاعر هستند و زبان خشم مردم جامعه او به شمار می‌روند. همیشه هم کارهایی که میکنن خیلی عجیب غریبه و خارق العاده و خیلی با طنز عطار اینها رو حکایت‌های مربوط به دیوانه ها رو بیان میکنه. مثلا در یک روز عید دیوانه از خونه میره بیرون و میبینه که همه لباس نو پوشیدن و آراسته و مرتب و دارن میرن مهمونی و این به خودش نگاه میکنه، میبینه کثیف و ژنده و پاره و گرسنه، سرشو میکنه رو به آسمان و میگه خب تو مگه منو نمیبینی؟ منم مثل اینا آدمم، به منم لباس بده، منم از تو میخوام، باید برای من لباس بفرستی، دستار بفرستی، نمیدونم کفش بفرستی، منم دلم میخواد امروز روز عیده و تمیز و خوب باشم. یه خورده وای میسته و میبینه خبری نشد، بعد میگه من بهت قول میدم تا سالی دیگه از تو چیزی نخوام، برای من حالا که نمیتونی لباس تهیه کنی دست کم یه دستار بفرست که سرم لخته. یک رندی از پشت دیوار این رو میشنوه و یک دستار کهنه و کثیف خودش رو از سرش باز میکنه و از بالا برای این پرتاب میکنه. دیوونه که این رو میبینه عصبانی میشه و اون رو پرت میکنه به سوی آسمان و میگه اینو بده به جبرائیلت، من از این چیزا نمیپوشم. و باز در جای دیگری وقتی که میره و غلامان و کنیزان آراسته امید خراسان رو میبینه، به خدا میگه از امید خراسان یاد بگیر و ببین که چطور باید بنده پروری کنی، منو اینجوری نگه داشتی و امید خراسان بنده هاش به این صورت هستن. در یک حکایت دیگر یکی از دیوانه ها رو در برابر امید خراسان قرار میده. این حکایت خیلی معروفه. امیدان کسانی بودند که دست کم در این دوره مورد نظر ما و در خراسان مسئول باج و خراج و امور مالیات بودند و همه ثروتمند بودند و این با واقعیت‌های تاریخی هم وفق می‌کنه، وفق داده میشه. کما اینکه سوری معتز یکی از امیدان خراسان در زمان غزنویان اینقدر ثروت داشت که سلطان مسعود غزنوی به اون حسادت می‌کرد و حاجب محمد امید دیگری بود معاصر عطار در دوره سلجوقیان که اون انقدر ثروت داشت که ضرب المثل شده بود و درباره ثروت افسانه او افسانه ها ساخته بودند. دیوانه دیگری میره داشته در بیابان میرفته و میبینه که بیابان از گله اسب ها سیاهه. میپرسه اینا مال کیه؟ میگن امید خراسان. یک کمی دیگه میره باز میبینه گله اسبان اونجا هستن، میگه اینا مال کیه؟ میگن امید خراسان. باز یک کمی دیگه میره و گله گوسفندان فراوانی رو میبینه که به شمار نمیان، باز میپرسه اینها مال کی هستن؟ میگن امید خراسان. یک کمی باز میره و غلامان و کنیزان زیبای امید خراسان رو میبینه که در زر و گوهر پوشیده شدن و اسبهای زیبا در زیر دارن و فخر میفروشن و خرامان و نازان دارن میرن. میگه اینا مالکی هستن؟ میگن امید خراسان. میره و به شهر میرسه و وقتی که وارد شهر میشه یک قصر زیبای سر به فلک کشیده میبینه و با جلال و شکوه و سرهنگان ایستادن به دوربرش و میگه اینا مالکیه؟ میگن امید خراسان. باز امید خراسان دیگه عصبانی میشه و باز همون دستار کهنه خودش رو از سرش در میاره و پرتاب میکنه به سوی آسمان و میگه اینم پس بده به امید خراسان. چون همه چیزی امیدت را سزاست، در سرم این ژنده‌گر نبود رواست. دسته دیگری، گروه دیگری که عطار در برابر خداوندان قدرت قرار میده، یک دسته دیگر از اینها رندان هستند. رندها کسانی هستند که قید دنیا را زدن، معمولاً در خرابات، در میکده‌ها و در جاهای بدنام زندگی می‌کنند و میخواره هستند. هر چی دلشون می‌خواد میگن، هر کاری دلشون می‌خواد می‌کنن و از هیچ کسی هم نمی‌ترسن. اینها هم تقریباً مثل دیوانه‌ها هستند. با این تفاوت که اونها بیشتر جلوی سلطان‌ها و پادشاهان رو می‌گیرن، اینها جلوی دسته دیگری که خداوندان ریا هستند. اینها جلوی در برابر زاهدان ریایی و صوفیان ریاکار قرار می گیرند. جای اینها در قلندرخانه ها، میخانه ها و خرابات هاست و معمولا اینها کسانی هستند که هرچند ظاهر آلوده و ناپاک دارند ولی درون پاکیزه و آراسته ای دارند، درونشون دلشون پاکه و از لاف و گزاف بیزارند و نه از بهش میترسند و نه از دوزخ. بیا تارند هر جایی بباشی، سر قوغا و رسوایی بباشی، نمیترسی که همچون خود نمایان اسیر بند خود رایی بباشی. بیا تا در تماشای خرابات چو رندان تماشایی بباشی. عطار در یکی از غزلهاش در جامعه یک زاهد در برابر اینها قرار میگیره، در برابر رندان قرار میگیره و یک گفتگوی کوتاهی بین یک زاهد ظاهربین ریاکار و دروغین و یک رند پیش میاد. سحرگاهی شدم سوی خرابات که رندان را کنم دعوت به طامات، عصا اندر کف و سجاده بر دوش که هستم زاهدی صاحب کرامات. خراباتی مرا گفتا که ای شیخ، بگو تا خود چه کار است از مهمات. بدو گفتم که کارم توبه توست، اگر توبه کنی یابی مراعات. مرا گفتا برو ای زاهد خشک که تر گردی ز دردی خرابات، اگر یک قطره دردی بر تو ریزم فرو مانی ز مسجد و از مناجات. برو مفروش زهد و خودنمایی که نه زهدت خرند اینجا نه طامات. بگفتین و یکی دردی به من داد، خرف شد عقلم و رست از خرافات. چون من فانی شدم از جان کهنه، مرا افتاد با جانان ملاقات. بهره‌گیری از زبان رمزی و نمادین و کاربرد واژه‌هایی مثل پیر مغان، خرابات، قلندر، می، مستی، دردی و دردیکش و واژه‌های دیگری مثل این، گذشته از تعبیرهای عرفانی، نوعی مبارزه با جزمندیشی و تعصب عصر بود. عطار در حقیقت در جامعه دیوانه‌ها و در جامعه رندان به اینها دهنکجی می‌کنه. در حقیقت رند حافظ میراثدار همین رند عطاره که با کمی ظرافت هنری بیشتر و با گستاخی بیشتر حرفش رو میزنه. لبه تیز انتقاد عطار بیش از همه متوجه کسانی است که اونها رو مسئول نابسامانی‌های اقتصادی، اجتماعی و فرهنگی می‌دونه. عطار به فرهنگ ایران باستان علاقه بسیار داره و اونطور که استاد علی نقی منزوی زنده یاد، علی نقی منزوی یادآور شدند و به گمان من کاملا هم درسته، عطار یک گنوستیک بوده. او به ادیان پیش از اسلام آگاهی کامل داشته، با اندیشه های زرتشت و مانی آشنا بوده، همطور با بودا، اندیشه های بودا و اندیشه های مسیحی، با تمام اندیشه های مختلف پیش از اسلام آشنا بوده و زیر تأثیر اونها هست و دو عنصر نور و ظلمت از عناصر اساسی اندیشه های عطاره که دائما در آثارش اون رو ذکر میکنه و تأکید داره بر اونها و حتی در همین داستان سیمرغ هم دست آخر سایه در خورشید گم شد و سلام، ظلمت در نور گم میشه و همینطور در مصیبت نامه. او در جای جای آثارش به اسطوره های کهن ایران اشاره میکنه و حتی اونها رو در قالب اصطلاح های عرفانی به کار میگیره، مثل پیر مغان، گبر کهن، کیخسرو روح، سیمرغ معنی، رستم جان، رخش فکرت و بسیاری دیگر و حتی رستم رو پیر راه میدونه، پیر که یک اصطلاح عرفانیه، رستم رو پیر راه میدونه. در چند جا هم خودش رو گبر خونده که البته توجیه و تفسیر عرفانی هم داره، ضمن اینکه یک جور دهنکجی به این ریاکارانه و میخواد در برابر اونها ایستادگی کنه. مسلمانان، من آن گبرم که بتخانه بنا کردم، شدم بر بام بتخانه در این عالم ندا کردم. عطار با چنین نگرشی حاکمان نورسیده سلجوقی و خوارزمشاهی رو جانشینان نابرحق پادشاهان قدیم ایران میدونه. در شعری در مورد کیانیان و اینکه اینهایی که بر تخت حکومت اونها تکیه زدن جانشینان نابرحق اونها هستن، این شعر رو میگه. البته شعر خیلی طولانیه و متاسفانه چون فرصت نبود من یال و دم این شعر رو کوتاه کردم. رفت نسل کیان، کنون بنگر تا کیان را کیان همی بینم. بر سر یوسفان کنعانی دو سه گرگی شبان همی بینم. بر سر هر خری که گاف سر است رایت کاویان همی بینم. به نظر عطار این جماعت تنها به فکر ثروت اندوختن و تهی کردن کیسه مردم و خوشگذرانی های خودشون هستن. گنج های بادآوردی که در مورد اینها وصف میکنه در داستان ها به نظر او حاصل دسترنج مردم زحمتکش جامعه است و البته اینها همه با واقعیت های تاریخی وفق میکنه. چنانچه وقتی که سلطان سنجر سلجوقی از خزانه دارش خواست که خزانش رو به اون نشون بده و اون آمد و اون خزانه گرانبها رو با اون همه در و جواهر و نقدینه و مجسمه و چیزهای مختلف بهش نشون داد، شرمسار شد و گفت که برای چون من کسی بده که بگن سنجر به مال متمایل شد، اینها رو ببر و ببخش به بزرگان. و همینطور در مورد محمد خوارزمشاه گفته شده، تاریخ نویسان نوشتن مثل ابن اسیر و فصیح خافی که تنها دو صندوق از صندوق‌های بیشماری که اون با خودش برد هنگامی که مغول‌ها حمله کرده بودند که به جای اینکه در برابر اونها بایسته و از این مال و اموال برای نگهداری سرزمینش استفاده کنه، گفته شده که دو تا از صندوق‌ها برابر خراج روی زمینه. خب البته ممکنه اغراق باشه، ولی منظور اون چیزهایی است که اینها داشتند و مردم در کنار اینها با اون ذلت زندگی می‌کردند. عطار معمولاً مردم فرودست و کارگران روستاییان اینها رو در برابر این خداوندان قرار میده. مثلا خشتزنی در جایی داره خشت میزنه و مقدار زیادی خشت زده، پادشاهی به اون میرسه و میگه این خشت ها به چند؟ و اون میگه تو را 10 خشت بس است، که در واقع به زبان کنایی میگه یعنی تو هم مثل همه میمیری و 10 خشت برای تو روی گور تو میگذارن. یا گازوری یا رخشویی که داره کرباس فراوانی میشوره بهش میگه که یک سلطانی بهش میرسه و میگه این همه کرباس به چند؟ میگه تو را 10 گز بس است، یعنی به اندازه کفنت برای تو بس. عطار دائما مرگ رو به اینها یادآوری میکنه. خودش هم در جایی گفته که مرگ اگرچه بس درشت و رهزن است، گردنان را نرم کردن واجب است. در یکی از حکایت ها که گفتم که عمید خراسان به دیوانه میرسه، اون به جای خود دیوانه دیگر هم دوباره سر راه بر پادشاهی میگیره و وقتی که این پادشاه رو میبینه چشمش رو میبنده. او بهش میگه چرا چشمتو میبندی؟ من اولوالامر جهانم و تو چطور جرأت میکنی چشمتو ببندی که منو در اینجا میبینی؟ و اون میگه تو چگونه اولوالامری هستی که اختیار نفست رو نداری؟ تو بر نفس خودت نمیتونی امر کنی، چطور میخواهی بر دیگران امر کنی؟ زاهدان ریایی. در آثار عطار معمولاً زاهدان به دو دسته تقسیم میشن. یک دسته اونها که زاهدان درستکاری هستند که طرفدار مردمند و معمولاً سر راه رو بر پادشاهان و زورمندان میگیرند و به اونها اعتراض میکنند و یک دسته اونها که زاهدان ریاکارند و تعداد این دسته دوم در آثار او بسیار زیاده و روی سخن اون دائماً با اینهاست و بر اینها خورده میگیره. چنان که در یکی از حکایت‌ها دیوانه‌ای وارد مسجدی میشه و میبینه که امام جماعت در اونجا ایستاده و داره نماز میگذاره. دیوانه میره و پشت امام جماعت میایسته و کمی که میگذره صدای گاو در میاره و حالت نشخوار نشون میده. بعد بهش میگن که برای چی این کارو کردی؟ چطور تو جرأت کردی چنین کاری انجام بدی؟ میگه امام من، امام و مقتدای من در حین نماز داشت به خرید و فروش گاو میاندیشید و من چون او امام منه به او اقتدا کردم. و البته این حکایت ها مبنای تاریخی هم داشتن، کما اینکه در اسرار و توحید شیخ ابو سعید ابوالخیر صوفی بزرگ قرن پنجم آمده که یکی از همین ائمه جمعه دیگه آخرین روزهای زندگیش بوده و ابو سعید میره بالای سرش که با اون دیدار کنه، دیدار آخر، و میبینه که داره سفارش میکنه فلان باغ من رو در فلان جا اینجوری کنید، این عمارت رو باید به این شکل بسازیم، فلان مال و ملک رو به این صورت نگهداری بکنیم. و او رو میکنه به اون امام و میگه امام اجل را، خواجه امام اجل را بهتر از این باید مرد. یا در یک حکایتی عطار بیان میکنه یکی از همین مفتیان، کسانی که فتوا میدن، بر در درگاه امیری نشسته، یک کسی میره اونجا و بهش میگه یک مسئله دارم میخوام از تو بپرسم. مفتی میگه اکنون چه جای فتواست؟ اون شخص بهش میگه بر در شاه و سلطان هم، بر در امیر و سلطان هم چه جای مفتیان؟ دسته دیگر صوفیان هستند که اینها هم باز در آثار عطار به دو دسته تقسیم میشن. یک دسته صوفیانی که مثل صوفیان تذکرت الاولیا که صوفیان خوبی هستند، یا اون صوفی بزرگ معاصر عطار شیخ نجم الدین کبرا که وقتی که مغول‌ها به نیشابور آمدند و همه رو از دم تیغ گذروندن، مغول‌ها این عادت رو داشتن که معمولاً صنعتگران، پزشکان و روحانیان رو امان می‌دادن و نمی‌کشتن و بعدها از اینها استفاده می‌بردن. چنگیز مغول پیغام می‌فرسته برای شیخ نجم الدین کبرا که آن بزرگ را بگویید که بیرون بیاد که من می‌خواهم که نیشابور را قتل عام کنم و نمیخوان که آسیبی ببینه. و او پاسخ میده که من تمام عمر در خوشی و شادمانی این مردم و در رنج اونها سهیم بودم و حالا میخوام در همین جا بمونم و در مرگ هم با اونها سهیم باشم. و به این ترتیب در نیشابور شهید میشه. اما صوفیان دیگری هستند که اهل ظاهر و ریاکاری هستند و عطار دائما با اونها مثل زاهدان ریاکار روبرو میشه. آخری صوفی مرقع پوش، لاف تقوا مزن ورع مفروش، صورت خیش را مکن صافی، یک زمان در صفای معنی کوش. یک بار هم یک مردی در ره گذر داره میره و یکی از همین صوفیان رو میبینه، چون معمولا اینها مطلوب مردم نبودن، این دسته‌ای که ریاکار و نادرست بودن، و یک کسی میره و سیلی میزنه به این صوفی یا پسگردنی میزنه بهش و این صوفی میگه این صوفی که تو به او پسگردنی زدی 30 سال است تا از خیشتن مرده است، تو به کی پسگردنی میزنی؟ در واقع یک جور لاف و گزاف دروغین که من مردم، از نفس مردم و من وجود ندارم. و او بهش میگه مرد گفتش ای همه دعوی نکار، مرده کی گوید سخن، شرمی بدار. با اینکه تصویر این ریاکاران رو پیش عطار پیش چشم مردم میگذاره و یا مستقیما با اونها صحبت میکنه، انقدر از ریای اینها بیزاره که حتی خودش رو در برابر اینها قرار میده و به رندی و مستی اقرار میکنه، که البته دور نیست از عطار که طرفدار ملامتیه بوده باشه و هست و اندیشه ملامتی در او بسیار قوت داره. ما اطلاع زیادی از زندگی اون همطور که گفتم نداریم، نمیدونیم آیا دقیقاً به همون شیوه زندگی میکرده یا نه، اما آثار بسیار زیادی داره به خصوص در غزلها که ملامتیه. ملامتی ها کسانی بودند که به فسق و نادرستی و مستی و رندی و شرابخارگی تظاهر میکردن به دو دلیل. اولا میگفتن میخوایم نفس خودمون رو خوار بکنیم و دوم اینکه میخواستن به این زاهدان ریاکار و دروغگو بگن حالا که شما میخواید تظاهر بکنید به دینداری، ما میخوایم تظاهر بکنیم به میخارگی و فخر بفروشیم به این، یه جور دهنکجی به این ریاکاران بود. معمولا عطار در این گونه غزلها از بیان پارادوکسی استفاده میکنه، چیزهای زد و نقیض رو کنار همدیگه قرار میده. ما رهز قبله سوی خرابات میکنیم، پس در قمارخانه مناجات میکنیم. یا مسلمانان من آن گبرم که دین را خار میدارم، مسلمانم همی خوانند و من زنار میدارم. در شعر زیر هم صریحاً خودش رو ملامتی میدونه و رند دردی خار مینامد. مرا قلاش میخوانند هستم، من از دردی کشان نیم مستم. نمیگویم ز مستی توبه کردم، هر آن توبه که از آن کردم شکستم. من آن روزی که نام عشق بردم، ز بند ننگ و نام خیش رستم. نمیگویم که فاسق نیستم من، هر آن چیزی که میگویند هستم. ز زهد و نیکنامی آر دارم، من آن عطار دردی خوار مستم. به نظر میرسه که تبرئه ابلیس هم که در آثار عطار فراوان میبینیم، یک جور دهنکجی به همین زاهدان ریایی باشه. عطار مثل هر مسلمان دیگری به تبع قرآن ابلیس رو رانده حق و نافرمان میخونه، اما شعرهای بسیار زیبایی داره که در ادبیات فارسی بی همتاست، در زیبایی بی همتاست. البته قبل از او کسانی مثل سنایی و بعدن مثل سعدی و مولانا در تبرئه ابلیس شعرهایی سرودن، اما به نظر من زیباترین سروده ها رو عطار داره و بیشترین رو. او معتقده که چون شیطان خدا رو سجده نکرد، این به معنای این نیست که او کافر بوده، به معنای اینه که او عاشق این خداست و میگه من نمیخوام کسی رو به جز تو سجده کنم. پس عارف حقیقی و عاشق حقیقی اوست، چون او تنها کسی بود که حاضر نشد در برابر غیر سجده کنه، چون گفت تو معشوق منی و بنابراین اون رو مظهر بیگناهی میدونه و او رو عاشق پاکباز و جوانمرد میدونه و زبان او میگه که لعنت خوشتر آید از تو صد بار که سرپیچیدن از تو سوی اغیار. کسی صافی هزاران سال خورده یا صافی هزاران سال خورده، نه اندک جام مالا مال خورده. به یک دردی که در آخر کند نوش، کجا آن نوش ها گردد فراموش. که شعر خیلی طولانیه، در واقع به خدا میگه من اون همه سالها به تو خدمت کردم و تو منو عزیز داشتی، برای این لعنتت من از تو بر نمیگردم و به غیر هم سجده، در برابر غیر هم سجده نمی کنم. و در واقع در برابر این زاهدان ریاکار میگه گر این مردی تو را بودی زمانی، ز تو زنده شدی هر دم جهانی. چو لعنت می کنی او را شب و روز، از او باری مسلمانی در آموز. در داستان معروف شیخ صنعان هم که یک شیخی است که معروف زمان خودشه، همه در برابرش سجده میکنن، بزرگ خانقاه، هزاران مرید داره و دخیل میبندند به او و به او اعتقاد بسیار دارند، عاشق دختر ترسایی میشه و از دین بر میگرده و قرآن میسوزونه، خوکبانی میکنه، هر کار زشتی که باید که نباید انجام بده انجام میده، شرابخوری میکنه که بتوانه به اون دختر برسه. و داستان خیلی طولانیه، در نهایت بر میگرده از این راه و دختر هم توبه میکنه و به راه این میاد و عطار در اینجا باز هم در برابر زاهدان ریایی میخواد بگه از راه کفر هم میشه به حقیقت رسید و تنها راه رسیدن به حقیقت عشق واقعی و از خود بیرون آمدن و کنار گذاشتن اون غرور و تعصب احمقانه و بیجایی است که شما دارید. شعر بسیار زیبایی در پایان، در اونجا که شیخ با مریدانش روبرو میشه و اونها ازش میخوان که دست بکشه از این عشق دیوانه‌وار، گفته در برابر عشق، ولی چون میدونم که وقت کمه من اون شعر رو نه آوردم نه میتونم بخونم اینجا، ولی به نظر من اون مانیفست عطار درباره عشق. رواداری و آسانگیری یکی از ارکان اصلی تصوف ایرانی پس از اسلامه و که بخصوص در عطار و در مولانا متجلی شده. او در برابر جزمگرایان و متعصبان و جاهلانی که دائما بر مردم خورده میگیرند و هی اونها رو این کارو نکن اون کارو بکن به اونها میگن و فرمان میدن به اونها و نمیگذارند که اونها زندگی عادی خودشون رو بکنند، دائما به اونها خورده میگیره و اونها رو سرزنش میکنه. یکی از چیزهایی که برای عطار خیلی مهمه احترام به دینهای دیگره. او معتقده که در این دنیای به این بزرگی برای تمام دینها و تمام مذهبها جا هست، برای پیروان همه عقاید جا هست و ما نباید متعصب باشیم و بگیم فقط من و فقط دین و نظر من. ای تعصب بند بندت کرده بند، چند گویی چند از هفتاد و اند، هست کیش و راه و ملت بیشمار، تا تو بشماری نیابی روزگار. بی تعصب گرد و بی تقلید شو، شرک سوز و غرقه توحید شو. او حتی تفتیش عقاید و پرسیدن از دین و ایمان دیگران رو هم زشت می شماره و دائما به مردم درس میده که از این کارها پرهیز کنید. چنانکه یک حکایت کوچیکی میاره که کسی از یک نفر میپرسه که دین تو چیه؟ تو به چه دین و آیینی هستی؟ و او بهش پاسخ میده، کوفی را گفت مردی رازجوی، مذهب تو چیست با من بازگوی. گفت این که پرسده ای کار لقا، ای ناخوش دیدار، باد پیوسته خدایم را بقا. یک قبله هست و همه اون رو باید بپرستید. عطار میگه او حتی درباره دگرباشان و کسانی که جنس دیگری دارند در ارتباط های جنسیشون خلاف روال معمولی میرن، درباره اونها هم شعر داره. به اونها میگه مخنث، زن مردان یا دگرباشان به قول امروز ما. چنان که در حکایتی یکی از همین دگرباشان داشته میرفته و میرسه به پیر بخارا که یکی از پیران معروف بوده، میرسه به او و پیر فوراً این دامن عباش رو جمع میکنه که به اون نماله و نجس نشه یا نانمازی نشه و میکشه کنار. و اون مرد، اون شخص بهش میگه تو کور حقیقتی، پاکی و ناپاکی افراد به درون آنهاست نه به بیرون آنهاست، تو چه میدونی؟ شاید در درون من قلبی صاف نهفته. باز در یک حکایت دیگر زاهدی رو میبرن که بر جنازه یکی از همین مفسدان نماز بگذاره و او میگه من این کارو نمی کنم، این مفسده و من آلوده میشم، فردا باید برم پاس جواب خدا رو بدم. شب میاد و در خواب اون رو میبینه، میبینه که در بهشته. به اون میگه تو چطور آمدی بهشت؟ من که نماز نگذاشتم بر جنازه تو. میگه گفت از بیرحمی تو کردگار کرد رحمت بر من آشفته کار. در مورد حیوانات هم باز این تساهل و تسامح در تمام آثار عطار و نه فقط عطار، دیگر صوفیان به چشم میخوره، به خصوص در آثار عطار که حتی یکی از این مشایخ بزرگ صوفیه برای اینکه مریدان رو درس بده یک سگ بزرگ سیاه رو با خودش میبره. وقتی که دعوتش کردن و سفره انداختن به احترام او، سگ و مینشونه پای سفره، مریدا به کراهت برمیخیزند و به انکار شیخ برمیخیزند و این چه شیخی که سگ آورده پای سفره. و اون وقتی که این رو میبینه با خیال راحت در کنار سگ غذا میخوره و از دهان سگ غذا میخوره و بعد به اونها میگه این سگ درون شماست، درون شما سگ نفس شما بدتر از این سگ ظاهری است. در حکایتی هم باز یکی از همین صوفیان میرسه به یک سگی و اون رو سگه میره جلوش که اون رو ناز و نوازش کنه و صوفی با عصا اون رو میزنه و سگ زخمی و خونین میشه و در همین موقع ابو سعید ابوالخیر صوفی بزرگ میرسه و اون رو سرزنش میکنه که چرا با حیوان بیگناه این کارو میکنی و اون میگه آخه من میخواستم که نانمازی و نجس نشم. بعد رو به سگ میکنه و از سگ عذرخواهی میکنه و سگ بهش میگه ای شیخ یگانه، چو دیدم جامعه او صوفیانه شدم ایمن که نبود زو گزندم، چه دانستم که سوزد بند بندم. هدف عرفان عطار این است که از انسان بدخوی دیوان صفت گرگ صفت جامعه خودش یک انسان به اصطلاح خود صوفیان انسان کامل یا انسان خداگونه بسازه، انسانی که در اون جامعه آشفته به هم ریخته جنگ زده و قحطی زده و گرسنه بتوانه روی پا بیسته و اون کارهای زشت رو انجام نده. در حقیقت اون میخواد از اون گرگ آدمی عصر خودش یک انسان بسازه و متناسب با شرایط فرهنگی و اجتماعی خودش تنها راهی که به نظرش میرسه که بتونه انسان عصر خودش رو تربیت کنه همین عرفانیست که ابراز میکنه، عرفان عاشقانه که پیرو مکتب خراسان بوده. حتی اصل عرفان او هم بر نبرد بین نور و ظلمت مبتنیست. او میکوشد تا همگان را در حرکت به سوی نور با خود همراه کند، زیرا آن را قلمروی امن میداند که نقطه پایان همه رنجهای زمینی است. ره یافتن به بقای پس از فنا نیست که اوج آموزه های صوفیانه است، از پویه و جستجوی همیشگی بشر برای دسترسی به جاودانگی خبر میدهد. گذر از اقلیم ناممکنها، رنجها و ممنوعیتها به بی نهایت آزادی و آرامش. نوشداروی هم که عطار برای جامعه جنگ زده، فقر زده و قحطی زده و بیچاره خودش در نظر میگیره عشقه. تمام هستی عطار بر مدار عشق گردیده و خلاصه عرفانش عشقه و توصیه‌ای هم که به همه میکنه اینه که برید عاشق بشید. عشق به تمام مظاهر هستی، عشق در تمام با اون معنای وسیع و گسترده‌ای که داره و نه تنها در یک معنا، که البته اون معنا هم جزء عرفان عطار هست و نه تنها عشق آسمانی داشته، در بسیاری از غزلها ما رگه‌هایی میابیم که عشق زمینی هم داشته و ابراز کرده. و این که بگیم فقط یک عارفی بوده که پاشو از زمین کنده و به آسمان رفته چنین چیزی نیست. او عشق رو فراتر از کفر و دوزخ و بهشت و جهنم، فراتر از کفر و ایمان و ننگ و نام میدونه. در چند جا هم مذهب خودش رو مذهب عشق میشناسه. ما مذهب عشق روی آن مه داریم و از هر چه جزوست دست کوته داری. عشق را با کفر و با ایمان چه کار، عاشقان را لحظه با جان چه کار. عشق تو با جان من در هم سرشت، من نه دوزخ دانم اینجا نه بهشت. خیلی متشکرم و مهرگان رو فراموش کردم تبریک بگم.
Mr. Shaheen Yusuf Zamani, who was born in Tehran in 1975 and graduated from the Tehran Conservatory and performed with Tehran Symphony Orchestra. He has performed internationally with many renowned artists, including Mohammad Reza Shajarian, Khashayar Etemadi, and Ali Reza Assar, among others. We have also Ms. Naghme Sarang, who is a skillful kamanche player, who was born, well, she wants the year, 1991. She was introduced to the music world through her father, Bahram Sarang, one of the well-known vocalists of classical Iranian music, and she started her academic musical education at the Tehran Conservatory in 2002. We also have Mr. Greg Ellis, who is a percussionist, composer, and producer living in Los Angeles. His work on drum set and hand percussion is known to millions of people around the world, performing and recording with such music luminaries as Zakir Hossain, Mickey Hart, Susanna Dehim, Mohsen Namju, and Pejman Haddadian. He's also a founding member of world music group VAS. Ellis released 4 critically acclaimed albums, and his CD solo, Kala Rupa, are among his works. And lastly, Ms. Shayan Dukhta Abedini Manish, who has been, of course, wonderfully present at our Jordan Center for Persian Studies for the past year, has been great help in promoting center and Persian culture. She's a singer and music researcher who has written 3 books for music with the title of Notation in Modern Music, under the supervision of Maestro Ali Reza Mashayekhi. Also, she has 2 books regarding Persian music repertoire for Oud, under the supervision of the late Maestro Mansur Nariman. Her instructors in Persian singing are Maestro Parisa, Maestro Mohammad Reza Shajarian. The program will go as such. There will be the Shur mode, and we are going to have, I think, 5 pieces, Tasnif Qadimi, Sazo Avaz, and then Tasnif Eivatan, and again Sazo Avaz, and Dar Payan Tarab, which is composed by Mr. Shaheen Yusuf Zamani. Please.
هر لحظه که بینمت فزونم تشنه من تشنه آن دو چشم مخمور تو من تشنه آن دو چشم مخمور تو عالم همه زین سبب به خونم تشنه من مای را که با گلستانم آرزو بن مای با یه باغ گلستانم آرزو از بکشای لب که غنده فراوانم آرزو کان چهره مشاشه تا با اونم آرزو یا کشور ما کشور ایران بود، مسکن شیران و در ایران بود، پادشاهش گورا شد دارا بود، چون خم خسرو شهر بالا بود. ای وطن ای حب تو
thank you.
گهی بر حال بی سامان بگریم، گهی بر درد بی مجنونم که دل بردارم از دوست، نه مجنونم که دل بردارم از دوست. مده یارو قلیل بیهوده پندم، مده یارو قلیل بیهوده ساغری بهج خم تناوری، باور دوست میرسد چه باوری چه باوری.
باده خورن غم مخوری، قصه زهر تم مخوری، روزی
کشور ما و کشور ایران بود گنج ایران و دل ایران بود پادشاهش کونا و شد دارا بود چون خم خسرو شهر بالو Thank you.